Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where everything we talk about is related to organizational health and the world of work. I'm your host, Pat Lencioni, joined by the regular full crew of Bo, Cody, Tracy. How are you? You're great. That's fantastic. Matt's behind the curtain or the glass. He's producing. Karen's sitting next to me, which I really like. And Cody, what are we talking about today?
Strategy takes courage.
That's right. And this is a pretty literal title, but one that a lot of people don't understand. To be strategic, most people think strategy is an intellectual thing. Like, oh, we have to be clever and outthink the competition. And there's an element of that for sure. But far more is based on having the courage to actually take bold action, to differentiate yourself, to give yourself a better chance to succeed than your competitors. And more often than not, the most strategic companies are the ones that have courage. And that's what we're going to talk about today. And this came about because I was doing a webinar recently for a bunch of priests, pastors who were running parishes. And I've talked to ministers about this. And if you want to have the very best possible organization, in their case, a parish, you have to have the courage not to be generic. And yet it's so easy to just do things the way they've always been done or do things the way people in your industry do them. And the best companies in the world have the strategy to be, or the courage to be strategic. And that's what we're going to talk about.
I love the way you open that up, Pat, because I think the, you said, hey, to take bold action takes courage. But the other part of strategy is what you say no to. And that takes courage. Like, because so many of those parishes that you talk to or businesses think, oh, the courage thing is for us to take every opportunity that comes along and we're just going to bootstrap it and make it work. And then they become generic because they don't know what to say no to. And I think that's an important piece of this courage part too.
You know, Cody, I think it might be worthwhile to actually talk about, because a lot of people say strategy. What is strategy? And I worked at a strategic management consulting firm for my first 2 years out of college, and I didn't really know what strategy was. And so when we started the Table Group 27 years ago, we decided, let's go figure it out. So we read all these books about strategy. The word gets used for different things. And essentially what it is, being strategic means you are going to make intentional decisions that differentiate you from others who do what you do, otherwise known as competitors, and that will give you a better chance to succeed than they do, than they have, because you've had that courage to do that. So that's what we're talking about. How can you be intentionally differentiated so that you will succeed and others will want what you have? Does that make sense?
So what's the connection between what you're talking about and simplicity? Is strategy all, is some of the strategy, that courage you're talking about, the courage to be more simple? Or is that not necessarily the case, that that maybe somebody's strategy is actually complex? Or Pat, are you saying simplicity takes courage?
I think that's, I hadn't considered that. I think that simplicity does take courage, but that's not to say that simplicity is the answer. It's like that's the only thing. It's being different and doing something that you don't know for sure if it's going to be successful, and that you might actually get made fun of or exposed if you do it and it doesn't work. And you're going to say, no, we think this is the right thing, so we're going to do it anyway. But you make a great point. It usually comes down to being simpler, because the idea of complexity is that we get to cover all of our bases, and it's harder to tell if we failed. But to make a simple, bold, strategic move leaves you open to the possibility of failure and embarrassment, I suppose. And that's where courage comes in.
I also hear this idea in your comments about action, that strategy is not just a document that lives in a computer. Strategy is a verb. Strategy is go do it, go start. And the bold action of a new creative idea or new product or the decision to simplify, all of that gets lived in kind of this do it now. You are not strategic if it's just living on a whiteboard. You are strategic if it's going, moving, driving.
I was working with the executive team of a university recently. Wonderful people. This is it's a really unique school. And they were talking about how they, when they go into the strategic planning process, it's very tempting to want to like make it really deep and really mechanical, so everybody knows exactly what to do. And the president said, you know, maybe what we need to do, and we were talking about this, is like, just make it so simple. And he said, here's the three things we believe. And of course, those are your strategic anchors. And we talked about how a good strategy empowers the people in the organization to look at those three things and make good decisions for themselves. But to do that, it takes courage, because if you get it right, now everybody's rowing in the same direction. But people will say, oh, but if we get it wrong, let's put a lot more detail in it to protect ourselves. Mm-hmm. And that usually means it actually doesn't get put into action very easily.
You know, it's interesting. I hadn't thought about this until both of you used this word in the last couple minutes. As you said, a lot of companies think of it as a strategic plan. And the idea of saying strategy versus strategic plan is kind of interesting to me, because strategy is this alive thing that we, you know, if we've simplified it in our own, I was just thinking, like, we've never sat in a room and actually done a strategic plan where we've mapped all this out. What we've done is we've sat in a room and said, does this fit in our strategic anchors? Do we say yes to this? And if the answer is yes, then let's move forward in the parameters of the strategy. So it is sort of interesting, even the language that we're using is like, if you're going in and executing on a strategic plan, that feels, you might just say that's a plan versus a strategy, right?
Yes. A plan is a document. A strategy is an approach.
Mm-hmm. So here's a real life way that this has played out in the last 8 days at the table group is, I love this distinction, Cody, between a strategic plan and strategic action. So we were on a Zoom call yesterday talking about some things related to Working Genius and how we might grow that. And Cody in the middle of the meeting said, okay, we're going to stop talking about it. And we're going to spend 5 minutes doing it. And we all then left the Zoom call and went and spent 5 minutes calling people, making some, you know, doing a little bit of galvanizing, a little bit of tenacity. And there's something about the decision to say, we're going to take strategic action. We're not going to try to perfect this. We're not going to try to get it perfectly codified in a Word document. We're just going to go do it and come back. That felt like strategy. And part of the strategy there is a quickness to learn, because chances are something in our Word document would be wrong. Something about the way we wrote it would be wrong. And in literally 5 minutes, we were able to pivot quickly to be more in line with those strategic anchors.
Yeah, publishing a document or writing a white paper doesn't usually take a lot of courage, but actually acting on it and putting yourself out there, I think it does. You know, I want to use an example, I think we talk about, like, Southwest Airlines for years had the most amazing strategy that differentiated themselves from everybody. And, you know, we talk about their strategic anchors, and they were like, we're going to make our planes on time. We're going to keep the fares low, and we're going to have really loyal customers. And that was their strategic outlook, plan, approach. And everything they did came down to those things. And yeah, if they had gotten those wrong, if people weren't interested in lower fares or quick turnaround or loyal customers, that could have been a bad thing. But they said, we're going to do that. And it took Herb Kelleher in 1969 courage to do that, because it was very different than the other airlines. Well, so I was working with this church, right? And the pastor of this church. And after COVID, a lot of people stopped going to this church. And so they were like, because it was a parish that was in a downtown area. And most of the people started then just going to church near their house if they went. And then when they opened up after COVID, this church, this parish was really struggling. So they brought in a new pastor, and he said, okay, what are we going to do to make this? And they embraced an entirely different, because in the Catholic world, one parish is like a lot, another parish is like another parish. And they kind of start to look generic. And in fact, over the years, a lot of them just do that. Well, we'll just do what the one down the street does. And he said, how are we going to be different? Because we're located in a downtown area, not in a suburb. We don't have a vibrant families all around us that come here. And so they're leaning into the fact that we're actually the church in a downtown commercial area. And we're going to have masses for people that are going to work and want to go there after work or during the day. And we're going to actually live into the fact that we are not serving like at most of the parishes around us, but we're going to be the church of business people and people going shopping and things like that. Now, they're in the throes of this right now, and it's going to take great courage, because everybody that works there is used to doing things like the generic parish. And they're going to put their nose, they're going to stick their nose out and say, we are going to do it differently. And people are going to accuse us of being crazy. And financially, we don't exactly know how it's going to work, but we think this is what we need to do. And it's not about them intellectually getting it. It's about, are we going to risk failure for the sake of something great? I hope that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that, I think that's an absolutely great example. And you even mentioned, you like threw Herb Keller in there. And I think like what, because we got an opportunity to meet Alan Mulally, and he was at Boeing when Herb was starting up. I remember this moment where Herb had an opportunity to use his strategy, and basically they were selling them planes. They were selling them 737s. And he said, basically the sentiment in the conversation was, oh, your cute little new startup plane company, once you graduate from the 737, you could end up buying the 777 and have a first class and do all these other things. And Herb, in that moment, not, he didn't take out the strategic plan and check what the document said about what they were going to do 10 years from now. He said, oh, no, we're only going to have one plane because our strategy is on time and that's going to help us. He's like, we're never going to buy your 777. And what was crazy is the sentiment in the room that I love is they kind of laughed at him, you know? Oh, that isn't that quaint, you know, was sort of the thing. The same as your parish is like, oh, you're going to try something different. And that is actually an alive strategy. He didn't have to pull and dust off the document to see what the answer to that question was. He knew it in his bones. And that's what I think is the distinction, that strategy is alive in every decision you're making, not that you have to go dust it off the shelf and figure out what the plan is based on some document we wrote up.
Exactly. And you know what I was thinking as you were saying that, Cody, is it's, and you don't feel safe when you have a bold strategy, because playing it safe is covering all your bases, trying to be all things to all people, and preventing anybody from criticizing you. And plenty of businesses go out of business because they play it safe and they don't really get criticized because, like, well, you played it safe and it just didn't work out. That's why this is about courage, because, you know, no risk, no reward. And that's not just financial. It's like you have to do something that others would probably say, that's just too risky for me.
So if you're a leader or a manager and you're hearing this and you want to motivate or inspire people to take some of that courage, how do you do that? How do you literally encourage the people that are around you, encourage your managers beyond saying, you can go do it? What is it that we can do to give more courage to the people around us to act like this, to think like this?
Well, I, before you answer that, Pat, I would say maybe there's a question even before that question, Bo, because I think there's probably a bunch of people who are listening to this to say, hey, that sounds great. I'd love for my company to have a simple set strategy. Mm. We don't. We have strategic plans. People are all over the place. How do you even get to that spot so that then we can have courage around it? Because like that's sort of a prerequisite, right? You have to know what your strategy is to then go out and be courageous around it.
I'm glad you said that, Cody, because I wasn't sure also, like Bo, because I think most of the time, if it doesn't exist above, I mean, most companies don't know, they don't fail to encourage people to act on their strategy. They don't even have a bold one, you know? And let me tell you another example, because I love when you get down to the tactics of this, and maybe this will get at what you're saying, Bo. So this one church, they have a woman that works there, and she does what's called, if I don't know if people know, but like confirmation. It's a sacrament in the Catholic Church, and her job is to get these kids in high school to come together and spend a year learning and studying, and then they get confirmed, okay? And it's a program and a process. Well, they had no families living at this parish. It was a downtown parish. They had three kids in confirmation. Do you know how many churches would, and you can apply this to business, continue to employ somebody to work with those three or four kids? And I said, no, send those kids to a different parish to get confirmed. And they're like, no, but they belong to our parish. It's like, yeah, but you're wasting resources. And just say, we're not a parish for teens. We don't have any teenagers here. We're going to let them do that. And we're going to use this woman to do something that actually serves the local business and commercial community. And they were really, when I suggested this, this woman was like, oh no, you're putting me out of a job. I can't believe you're saying this. And I said, wouldn't you rather use your time and energy to doing something that was going to actually make a difference and bear fruit than working with those same three or four kids for a year and feeling like, oh, this is a waste of time and energy? And they were all actually relieved to think, we could do that. Now, other people are going to go, yeah, but those four kids that go to that other church, maybe they're going to start going to church there and they're not going to put money in the basket at the. And it's like, take that risk. Mm-hmm. But if you're unwilling to let go of something And if you're unwilling to make that person who's in charge of that uncomfortable, you're never going to. And so the question is, why do we hesitate to have a bold strategy? Because somebody's going to lose out in the short term. We're going to risk losing a customer or an employee. And so we go, oh, well, we're going to have to keep doing what we've done in the past. And that's a recipe for mediocrity and failure.
That feels to me like part of the key of that story is the decision not just to say, oh, we're not going to do that, but to say, here's the thing we're running boldly towards, right? Yes. It's not just the restaurant saying, we're not going to do drive-through because we don't want to do drive-through. It's like, no, we serve great food that's going to taste better. So we decide we can't do that in drive-through because it's going to hurt the experience. Or the business that says, no, we're going to keep having somebody on the phones. We're not going to use, you know, a third party to answer the phones because we're protecting, we're doing something boldly in a direction, not just cutting things.
Yes. And you have to know what you're running to first, but you can't get there first. And a lot of people will say, well, let's try that. And if that succeeds, then we'll let go of the other one. No, you will not succeed until you let go of the other one. So, because you're right. If they say, well, let's keep doing this and then we'll try to use her to do something else. And if that starts to work, then we'll let go of it. No, you have to let go, like the trapeze art. You have to let go of the last rung and spend some time in the air before you reach the next one. And most of us think, well, let's just make it an easy transfer. Like Bill Bridges has in transition management. You have to let go of the last thing you were doing before you get comfortable with the next thing. And that's not human nature, but it's what separates great organizations from others.
And it is interesting, even after 15 minutes of this conversation, Pat, to have used the word courage and the way that you're describing it, because if there is no risk, then there's no requirement of courage. You know, like if you feel like, so everything you've just described, both from the church and the business side, is like, there's a risk there. Otherwise, it wouldn't take courage. And so strategy requires courage. And like, otherwise you're just like, we have the plan, we do everything that we're confident about. Like, you know, and I even think back a couple of years ago in our own business, there was a thriving, you know, network of consultants that we were, you know, stewarding. And it actually, in terms of revenue and experience and impact, it was all going great. And it didn't quite meet our strategy. And we had to have the courage to risk that and shut it down. And then 2 years, you know, in the rearview mirror, we're like, oh man, so much of this content is getting out in ways that it never would have had we just been beholden to something that worked. Like if we didn't want to take the risk of doing it a different way.
Karen just wrote me a note that I think is really interesting, because we talk about this word empowerment. And the best way to empower people is to say, this is our bold strategy. Here are the guardrails or the guidelines. Now, go do whatever you think is right within those guardrails. But that requires letting go of some control to the employees. You're still getting to give them the boundaries, but you're saying you get to make decisions within those boundaries versus we're going to tell you, we're going to micromanage you along the way. And that alone feels risky, but it is, you know, when you work at a company that has a bold strategy that says, this is what's most important, it's even at the risk of failure, it's far more important, better working there. And if you work at a company that says, we're going to mitigate our risks, working there feels like I have to check with a bunch of people. I have to cover my butt. And you end up playing defense all the time instead of offense. And another thing about this, and war is not something to be looked at lightly. It's a horrible thing. And thank God that most of us aren't having to do that. There's people in the world that are, and I hope that peace prevails and all that. I mean, because I don't want to use a war analogy. But they say in war that when you're not sure what to do, do something bold and you'll learn from it. And people will be at least engaged, because when soldiers are sitting there going, we don't know, we're waiting for directives from people, they're just sitting there and they're worrying and they're feeling exposed. And it's always better to take bold action after thinking through it than to wait for the perfect answer, because while you're waiting, bad things happen. All right? So courage. More important than intellect. Everybody thinks it's the clever company that's the most strategic. It's often one that's clever enough, but has the courage to pursue something. All right. Is there more that we need to say? We can wrap that up right now. All righty. Unpaid ad today. I think it's over to Bo and Cody.
And I've tried to fire Bo from this, but I can't think of anything. So go ahead, Bo. You can have another shot here. But if it's croutons or another fireable offense, this might be your last.
Hey, before I do the unpaid ad, I want to just make a comment about something related to this podcast, which is at this podcast release about a week into something called Lent. Now, there's a bunch of people all across different faiths and faith interests that listen to this podcast, and we love that.
Yep.
And one of the things I've learned being next to you, Pat, as a devout Catholic, is the importance of the Lent season. And I just thought, this is a good moment to pause and say, hey, if you're a week into Lent and you've not given anything up or you're not really sure what to do, Lent is the season leading up to Easter, I would just remind our audience about your new podcast called The 3-Minute Reset, which is literally a 3-minute opportunity every day to get some insight about something related to faith in the workplace. And there's no pressure there or expectation, of course, but we'd love for you to subscribe. And I think this is a great season to say, hey, don't miss an episode. If you've got 30 days or 15 days left of Lent, it's something very simple that you could do leading up to the Easter season.
Well, and the idea of Lent too is giving stuff up. And even people I know that don't have the same faith as me or none at all, I think during Lent, they think, hey, I'm going to do that thing with you guys. I'm going to give something up. And the idea there is a little bit of suffering makes us better. And it helps us to appreciate what we have. And it helps us understand that for those that are Christian, this is a time of thinking about the difficulty leading up to Easter and Good Friday and everything else. But other people, I love when people in an office go, hey, what are we all giving up for Lent? Or what are we going to do differently for Lent? So maybe that's the unpaid ad today. It's for doing that. And if it's the podcast, that's fantastic.
I love it. I was going to say the unpaid ad today is for phone calls, because I think before the days of Zoom, we all would just pick up the phone. And now the world of Zoom, we wait to have everything scheduled. And I think it actually sometimes limits courage. It slows things down. And I love hearing when somebody just picks up the phone and says, hey, let's just talk for 5 minutes. So
yeah.
I was going to say today's unpaid ad is for phone calls.
All righty. So
you're not fired. That's great. I like that one. Thanks, Bo.
Nice. All righty. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Have courage, be strategic, be bold, and we'll talk to you next time on At the Table. God bless.